forever and ever. It's an easy song and we all sing together. So in a worship mode, you can worship with us by singing this beautiful song. Asante, Nasema, Asante, Sana. Yep. Everybody understands. Thank you. God bless you. And it's a very great time to introduce the speaker. I would ask Chelsea to do that because this is a very special time to do that. And God bless. Yeah.
So that means you have to get off the stage. Just kidding. Just kidding. So Hellen has been a really good friend to me for many years. She's the reason why I went to Kenya and why I have this handsome husband of mine all the way from India. I met Hellen down in Lake of the Ozarks when I moved down there after graduation from college. Hellen was always so fun to be around. And I told her if I'm going to Kenya, I'm going to really need a friend in Kenya to help me get around, and she offered to do that. So she was also teaching me Swahili, And I was trying to tell her that I love her in Swahili. So I said, Nakupunda, but that means I donkey you instead of I love you. Because punda means donkey in Swahili. And it's Nakupenda. So I apologize again for telling you that I donkey you. But Nakupenda means I love you. So I was doing really well on my Swahili. I was pretty fluent by the time we left the 32 days. And she was one of the very few people who didn't tell me that I was crazy for falling in love in 2 weeks on a mission trip. She supported Babu and I from the beginning. I know that when the world was telling me that I was crazy and what kind of water did I drink there in Africa and who convinced me, how much was he paying me, and all of those kinds of things, she just reassured me that it was God and to follow the path that God has set me on. And so I'm happy that she was there by my side to encourage me. And I love Hellen. So why don't you come up here? I'll pray for you before you preach today. And I'm excited to hear what she has to tell us. Dear Lord, we just thank you for Hellen. We thank you for her life, Lord. We thank you for you for allowing our paths to cross and become friends and then family while we were in Kenya, Lord. And I just pray that you will speak through her today. Use her, Lord. I just pray that she can share from her heart, Lord, for whatever you have laid on her heart, Lord. Give her confidence and, Lord, just give her the word from you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, church, again. Buona sifiwe. You say amen. Buona sifiwe. Buona sifiwe tena. Thank you so much for inviting me here. Before I commence, I'd like to introduce my wonderful husband that God blessed me with, if he'll just stand. His name is David Armstrong. He's the reason why I'm still in America to date. But all glory and honor is to God because he does wonderful things. Today is his day and he wants us to rejoice. I am so blessed. The compliments Chelsea is giving me, they are not all for me, but for his glory because it was his timing. It wasn't my timing. He just made it possible for everything to happen. And today we have Noah and Grayson, and that is all from God. Why do I go to mission trips? These are the reasons why I go to mission trips. Not to find people, husbands and wives, but to go share his glory, to go share his story, which is not my story, but his to tell. And today I want him to use me to speak the words in me to you all this morning. Thank you so much for allowing me to be here again. And we have our 4-year-old wonderful daughter, Hannah, and some of you have met them. These are precious gifts to me, given to me by God. God tells us, there's no tear that you shall shed that he will not wipe. I met them at a time when I'd just gone through a tragedy. My mom had just passed away. But before my mom passed away, my mom came to the U.S. very sick. And God blessed my mom and blessed me, because after her death, I went to God, and I cried to him, and I said, you didn't bring me 10,000 miles in 1 week to send word back home that she's leaving this world. And God gave me 5 great months with my mom. And so my journey began, and then he restored me because of my husband and my daughter. That is the restoration from our God. So this morning, I'm here to share with you of God's timing. 5 years ago, I would tell you I didn't even know that I would be in America. It was not my dream. But his timing, because he tells us in Jeremiah 29:11, for I know the plans that I have for you. They are not plans to harm you, but to give you a future and a hope. And the hope is what I live by. Today, he has given me this great pleasure to be here at Lighthouse Calvary. Did I dream about that? No. It's all he's doing. He brought me here today to share his story with you all this morning. And so I come before you this morning also to share about his goodness. He did not only bless me with a husband and a daughter. He has blessed me more than I can ever imagine. Today, the statistics talks about 2+ billion people who are enriched with the gospel. We see Matthew 28:19. He talks to us about reaching the whole world and the nations. When I go on mission trips, I imagine all those enriched people, who is going to reach them if I don't answer to his call when he says, whom shall I send? And I say, here am I, God. May you send me. And that you find in Isaiah. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. He reminds us in Matthew 24:14, he has given us authority that to go out there and let no fear come your way to distract you. Do not fear. If I go to Africa, if I go to India, if I go to Asia, what's going to happen to me? He is taking care of you. He is taking care of your family that you're leaving behind. They're sacrificing to let you go. He is sacrificing to have you go there and protect you. If he did that, it was right for you to not come back from there. That is his timing. That's where he wanted you to be. You glorify because he has given you that opportunity to be there and to go in a way to say, I did not make it back, but it was for his glory. I was doing his work. How awesome is that? How can you want to miss that out? Anybody tell me, how would you want to miss that out? He sent Abraham from his land. He sent Abraham to foreign land. Did he know that was going to happen? No, he protected him. He watched over him. We serve a living God. We serve a God who knows what he does. We serve a God who keeps his promises. And that's the God that I serve. That's the God I wake up to every morning because he gives me the greatest joy. Today, not so many woke up to this day. I woke up, I have breath of life. Isn't that something to be thankful about? Yes, it is. And so I am so thankful that I am here. The statistic tells us there are about 6,900 people that have not been reached in the world. The statistics also share that these people have no idea who God is. What a joy to go out there and tell them of his glory, to tell them of his unconditional love that we do not deserve, but he still gives it to us. How can we miss out on that? In 2007, I started my mission journey, and God blessed me because a gentleman in my church then told me, the moment you go on a mission trip, your life will be changed. I'm a testimony today that God has changed my life. And every year, I long to hear him tell me, where can I send you today, my daughter? And I want to go there and reach out to the unreached. I'm thankful that I have a supportive family that lets me go and let me reach that my passion for the missions. In 2007, he blessed me. I went to an area, northeastern part of Kenya, where it's a dominated Muslim place. Just they are bordering Somalia and Ethiopia, and you're just like, I'm not sure, because we had to go wee hours in the morning just to avoid the bandits. In that place, it's a northern part of Kenya, it's a tribal, and the girls and considered if somebody heard that his wife was pregnant, there we don't have ultrasounds, we don't have reveal parties, we don't know what we are having until the child is here. And a father would walk away and not want to see that daughter because to them that would be an abomination to have a child, a girl daughter in that family. So they could be left in the forest for wild animals to eat them, they don't care. They want a son. The women have to do the house chores, they have to build their homes, they take care of the cattle, and they do all that. Another challenging thing that I saw when I was there is the girls, they get their periods, they don't have the sanitary pads, and so embarrassment makes them not want to go to school. And so we were able to provide the sanitary pads, we were able to share with the girls that got lucky to be alive, that were wanting to go to school and share their education. Come 2013, God had plans for me because I came to America in 2010. Come 2013 and 2014, God opened up another door for me. I just shared a story with somebody in my church. It's Potter's House. And when he opened those doors for me, I talked to a friend and I said, hey, do you mind? We were talking about Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes that we send out every year. And she happened to have been in the mission team, and she said, oh, but I asked her, do the shoeboxes go to Kenya? And she said, actually, we have a team that, I don't know if the shoeboxes go to Kenya, but we have a mission team that are looking for a place to go. And it was me and 7 other people. You see that area? That's Mathare slum. It's a slum area. It's one of the largest slum areas in Kenya. It's got a population of about 500,000 people. Most of the children here live with their guardians because their parents passed away. So they are with their guardians or the siblings. And when we had that trip, we also got a chance to go to a school in Kakamega, that's the western part of Kenya. And we met some kids who don't get to have the privilege of wearing shoes in their junior years. If at all, they get to have shoes when they go to high school, if they make it. And most of these children are being brought up by their 80-year-old grandmothers because their parents have passed away. And so we find maybe a parent passed away, the mother passed away during childbirth. And so the grandmother, who does not even have a job and is fending for herself from her garden, has to sacrifice to make sure at least these kids go to bed, even if it's just one meal a day. They're able to have that meal. And so when we took shoes to them, these children, give them a flip-flop, you have brought Christmas to them way earlier than they even anticipated on it happening. When they saw those flip-flops, we brought bread and sodas to them. They didn't care about that. They were holding on to that flip-flop, a flip-flop, to their dear life, because they did not even want it to even for a minute to be away from them. They just hanged on to it. So when you throw away your flip-flop, there's a child in Bukurimo who will take that flip-flop with open hands and take it to her and just be like, know that there's a God that loves them that sent them that flip-flop. In 2013, that's when Chelsea and I went and Sarah, and we stayed in the Mathare slums for a month. I did meet Babu on my first trip in 2013, so Chelsea and I went in 2014, and we got to share more, and we got to meet more people. And ever since we've gone to Mathare, on our first trip, we did not know, coming back, what's going to happen to Mathare. I had no idea. When I came back, the whole team, everybody was like, I need to sleep, you know, and think this through. I'm not sure if this is the route to go. And from that trip, the Lake Area Mission Builders took the leap of faith to be together and set up and help these children. These children would come there at the church. It's called Sedo in Mathare. And these children would come there because that's where they can get a meal, if not two, per day. The parents don't know where the meals are going to come from or the guardians that they live with. And so when they come, the church said, we just don't want them to come get a meal, but we want to give them education. And as I said, God has the plan. And God does not start a job that he does not see to completion. Today, when we started this trip, it was a leap of faith. We did not know where God would take us. Today, as I talk to you, we have about almost getting to 80 children being sent to high school. 80 children. Every year we have 20 children. We have over 40 children that sit for the exams, and 20 get scholarship. And now then, some of them have already gone to do, they are doing their last year, the 4 years since we started this trip. And some of them are starting a new year because every year we get. And in 2018, when we went back, we got to go with the sponsors, and the sponsors got to meet the children in Mathare. And they also got to walk in Mathare and to get a view of what Mathare and what we are talking about. Sometimes in the mission experience, I will tell you what I know because I've lived there. But until you go there, you will get to get the experience of what those people's life live like, or what they are, you know, everyday challenges that they face. I know challenges is just not in Africa. The challenges are all over the world. But sometimes you have to speak from what you know because of what you have lived. There are challenges here, out there, America is put up here. Because to them, they do not know that America also gets to go through the natural disasters, the things that happen here, the flooding, and all the, you know, the homeless people. And I share this because somebody asked us, so tell us about America. How is it like? And then we start telling them, oh, in America, we have homeless people. In America, we have flooding. People's houses are destroyed by the tornadoes and the hurricanes. And they're like, oh, wow. Like, it's shocking to them because this is heaven. This is heaven. That's there. That is why they have that, oh, I want to go to America. But the life here, and then when you get to meet them and share this story, because it is your story, it's not your story to tell, but you tell it because God is asking you to share that story. And they get to hear it. And so we moved. And while I was in Msedo in Mathare, I also got a chance to go to Uganda, which is a neighboring country. And in Uganda, I was in an orphanage that I got to meet with these children who are living in an orphanage. And these children get to come here also and get a meal. And that's why they all come here. There's a lady, a couple that has opened up their home to allow these children to come there and get to have a meal and get to get education also. And they're getting all the sponsors and all the help that they can from this side of the world. And one thing I like, and I say, God has blessed America because America is very good-hearted at giving. And then the third world, they are also blessed in a way that I live here to go to maybe Africa, and there is wildlife. That there is a blessing. Doesn't that bring you the picture of Noah and the ark and all the animals? And then you start looking at all that creation and say, wow, you know, they are not that poor as you might think because they are so blessed with all this wildlife, and you get to enjoy that. So that is one advantage that they have. So as we go, and that's in the Uganda, it's the neighboring countries that we get to meet. Robert is one of the couples, that get to take care of these children and experience their lives, because all these are also children that are missing one parent, or some of them, the parents died in an accident, or they died through disease, or something happened that they do not have their parents with them. And so they are living with their grandmothers, and that's the kind of life that is back out there. And as we move on, so this year, I kind of wanted a feel, a different feel. And I prayed to God, and I said, God, where do you want to send me? And I said, here, my God, I will heed to your call. And I got a chance to go to the Philippines. But before I get into the Philippines, I wanted to share a story of a girl in Mathare. Her name is Doreen. Doreen doesn't have parents. Doreen was living with her aunt in the rural. And then the aunt decided, I want to send her to Nairobi, which is the capital city, because a majority of the people leave the rural to go to the urban centers in search of jobs. And so Doreen is one of the girls that live in the rural area. And so the teacher was sharing with us Doreen's story. When Doreen was sent to her from the rural, she was asked to have Doreen as a house help. And so when Doreen was there, she looked at Doreen, and she imagined, do I want to make her my house help, or would I rather send her to school? And so she put the question to Doreen and gave her that choice. If you want to go to school, or do you want to be my house help? And Doreen chose to go to school. Lo and behold, Doreen was one of the students when the scholarship came up. She was one of the students that was able to get a scholarship. She was one of the first recipients of the scholarship, of being able to go to high school. That is hope. Doreen was given a hope. These children in Mathare are getting a hope every day when they find somebody to sponsor them. You're giving them hope for education, because that is not what they dream of. That is not what they know. But that is an opportunity that happens to come by them. Then this time I got a chance to go to the Philippines. In the Philippines, we have two tribes. We have the Bukolo tribe And then we have the Tigalo. We got a chance to go to this place. It's called the Bicol. And we got to share our testimonies with the people. One thing I found when I went to the Philippines is they are humbled. They go through all these natural disasters. But when you come there and knock their doors and you want to hear, they give you the time to hear the word, to hear you share your testimony. And when you share your testimony, it helps them know that they are not alone, that the suffering they have gone through relates to your story when you share your story. So when we went to the Philippines, we got to hike. There was a lot of hiking and going up the mountains. And we got to cross. The moment when we were about to cross, when we just got to the land because we were going to a different village, there was a downpour. Lots of rain coming down, and we were to cross over with the boat to go to the other side of the mountain. And so what came into my mind at that very moment, I just saw when Jesus was crossing over with the disciples, going to reach the unreached and sharing in the gospel, and Peter being scared and saying, "Oh, Lord, help me, Lord, help me." And that was the picture paint for me that moment. I was so thrilled because I was not there during that time, but it felt like living that moment. And so when we went to the Philippines, and we were kind of encouraging them and talking to them, and we met a guy, his name is Wilson. And Wilson shared with us a story after one of us shared her story. And Wilson shared with us the story about his wife. Wilson and his wife, they live far away from family. And so it was just the two of them. And his wife was pregnant with their second child. And she started having pain while she was at work. And her boss took her to work and called Wilson and said, "Come follow us because your wife is in so much pain. We need to go to the hospital." When they went to the hospital, they checked her pain and they told her the baby was growing in the wrong area and they needed to terminate that pregnancy. So Wilson came and was able to reach, and he went down and prayed to God, and he left everything to his will. There's nothing so good, so better when you say, "God, let your will be done." Because when God's will is done, you will share your testimony of his will. So Wilson went in. His wife had the test done. They took out the baby. And they don't have machines, breathing machines. So he was given this pump and was told, "You gotta pump this. The moment you stop, your wife will be dead." He pumped that machine for 5 hours. He was all by himself. Nobody even coming there to say, "Let me sit by and help you." After 5 hours, the machine had a straight line, and Wilson thought his wife was dead. And he prayed, and he prayed, and the next morning, his wife woke up. Can we not praise God for that? Can we not say our God is good? He is good all the time, because he doesn't disown his children. He never disowns his children. And God hears even whispers of prayers that we send to him. And he knew Wilson was desperate. And he answered Wilson. Today, Wilson's wife may have not had that second child, but she is living. She is a testimony. We went to this house. It's a cloud house. And the cloud house, you go to the Philippines and you see the children laying on these bamboo beds. And I saw a 4-month baby laying on the bamboo bed. And I was like, how does it feel? How can you not be thankful when you have a mattress? When you watch a four-month-old baby sleeping on the bamboo with nothing, they have this small room, and it's one bedroom, and the bed is bamboo, and the grandparents, the parents, the children, they all sleep in that one room. The kitchen, the rooftops, the rain comes in, and it goes through because what they have is a thatched, and the rain comes in, and you don't even know how they're going to have a meal the next time it doesn't rain. And we had to experience the first storm. And we met a guy whose son had just died in December through a mudslide. Revelation 5:7 reminds us that God says he doesn't disown us, but he'll always be with us. And that they sang a new song saying, "You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you were slain, and with your blood you purchased for God's persons for every tribe and language and people and a nation." How is it possible that the same story she shared this morning? Isn't that God doing the same thing that he wanted us to share that story this morning? Isn't God saying something to you this morning? Look into your hearts and look and let your heart and your soul speak and let him in. There's nothing so best than letting the Spirit be in control of your life. There's nothing so good when you live in faith and tell of God's goodness. And we see that when you go on mission trips. You see their challenges and you see God's goodness in their lives. You see how God is touching them even though they are far away. God wants us to spread his word. God wants us to do this for his glory. It's for his glory. It's for his glory, his children. We went and met these two tribes. It's the tribe of the Bukolo and the tribe of the Tagalog in the Philippines. They were headhunters. The Bukolo team were headhunters. You needed to bring a head for you to get into the next stage of life. And they would bring any head. And I asked this guy, how did they pick who to bring? And he said to me, they did not. You could bring even a child's head. You could bring a pregnant woman's head. You could bring any head. So long as you brought a head, that would bring honor and glory to them. And so I want us to watch a video clip on the story of the Bukolo and the Tagalo in the Philippines.
Hi, we are Steve and Jen Hagen, and we have three kids, Michaela, Zach, and Ben. We are from Central Missouri, but we have served in the Philippines for 8 years. We are based in the beautiful Bicol region and live in a small town at the foot of a volcano. However, because we work with tribal people, we travel a lot and often camp out in mountain villages, sometimes for several months at a time. The kids are key members of our team, and this would not be possible without their help. We often hike long distances through the mountains, and the kids have become great hikers, even helping to carry our supplies. They also help by hauling drinking water for us to boil, scrubbing our laundry down by the river, keeping village kids occupied so the adults can focus on the meetings, completing their schoolwork on the go, sharing Christ's love with those we meet, and maintaining great attitudes in the face of challenges. It isn't all work, though. We also have a lot of fun and some crazy adventures along the way. We even rappelled off a bridge to cross a flooded river. God is using them mightily in the work here, and we are so thankful to have them as part of our team.
The Philippines is a spectacular display of the amazing diversity of God's creation. As we travel through the gorgeous islands and majestic mountains, the beauty of His handiwork often takes our breath away. But nestled in these mountains is something far more precious to God than waterfalls and mountain streams. In these mountains, you will find the tribal people of the Philippines, people whom God dearly loves, people whom He gave His Son to save. But some of these tribal people are isolated from this good news. They desperately need to hear that Jesus Christ died for them. But because of their remote location, difficult language, and unique culture, they are dying every day without that chance.
We want to introduce you to two tribal groups in the Philippines. First, these are the Bukolot tribal people. The Bukolot are an incredibly proud tribe who control the Sierra Madre mountain range. Not many years ago, anyone near these mountains lived in absolute terror. You see, the Bukolot were fierce headhunters. In Bukolot culture, the pinnacle of achievement was to take a human head. It was what young boys dreamed about, and they spent years preparing for this rite of passage. A young man could not get married or hold a leadership position in the village until he had taken a head. They had no regard for human life and would kill man, woman, or child to satisfy the demands of their culture. But God is not willing that any should perish, even the Bukolot headhunters. In a phenomenal story of God's faithfulness and protection, missionaries risked their lives to bring the gospel to the Bukolot people in the 1950s, and the Bukolot church was established. While I was a child, my parents were some of the later missionaries to the Bukolot people. They worked to disciple the church leaders. I grew up in the Sierra Madre Mountains in a Bukolot village, so this particular tribal group is near and dear to my heart.
Now let us introduce another tribal group to you. The Akta tribal people are a Negrito group, which means that their appearance resembles African pygmies with darker skin and curly hair. The Akta are the lowest of the low, and the poorest of the poor. Racial discrimination against them runs rampant. The Octa don't own any land, so they are squatters or sometimes tenants for others who often take advantage of them. They are thought to be lazy, stupid, and incapable of learning or accomplishing anything. And sadly, most Octa even seem to believe this about themselves. Their tribal group name, Octa, is actually even used as an insult, meaning stupid or ignorant. Many have tried to bring the gospel to the Octa people, but they are very suspicious of outsiders and believe that they are too stupid to understand the Bible anyway, so the Octa continue to live in darkness. This is the tribal group to which God has called us, and we started out by trying to plant churches in Octa villages. By God's grace, we did see some fruit. A few baby churches were born, and new believers were baptized. However, we saw that there were multiple barriers to us being able to effectively reach the entire Octa tribe. Two key ones are their four distinct heart languages and a culture that tells them they are too stupid to understand the Bible or lead a tribal church.
As we prayed about how to more effectively reach the Octa, God planted an idea in our hearts. How cool would it be if God could use the Bukalot tribe to reach the Octa tribe? Now that we had new Octa believers, we decided to try to connect the two groups for the very first time. Steve loaded 8 Octa men in our vehicle and drove them about 20 hours north to visit the Bukalot tribal church. It was amazing how quickly the two tribes connected at a deep heart level, and, as fellow tribals who truly understand one another, the Bukalot were able to speak into the lives of the Octa believers in ways we would never be able to. The Octa men also saw an indigenous tribal church, led entirely by tribal believers, thriving without any outside influence. They had always believed the lie that tribal people are incapable of independently leading a church, but they saw the truth in action before their very eyes, and it rocked their world. For so many reasons, that visit confirmed in our hearts that the most effective way to reach the Octa tribe would be through other tribal believers, so we began seriously praying about how to make that possible. My parents were no longer living in the Philippines, but we approached them about the possibility of partnering with us to empower the Bukalot tribe to reach the Octa tribe. After much prayer, my parents decided they were on board, and that's when the real adventure began. We started a whirlwind of 18 months of traveling in and out of Bukalot villages, spending extended time with their churches to determine if they were interested in helping to reach the Octa tribe and to figure out how to help them make this dream a reality.
It became quickly evident that the Bukalot church truly had a deep passion to be a part of the Great Commission. Because of God's infinite grace, He had sent missionaries to these bloodthirsty headhunters, and the gospel had changed their lives forever. Now they had the opportunity to be the ones to bring the gospel to another tribal group, and they were incredibly excited. We also determined that in order to make this happen, they needed help in two key areas: training their missionaries and supporting their missionaries. Our family then spent more time with each of the Bukalot churches, helping them to better understand what it would look like to send out their own missionaries, including the sacrifices involved. After a couple months, at their request, the churches gathered for a day of prayer and fasting to make some big decisions. If they still wanted to send out missionaries, who they wanted to send, and where they wanted to send them. God worked mightily, and the end result was that 6 families and 6 single men were sent out from the Bukalot tribe to partner full-time with us to reach the Octa tribe.
We divide.
And the story goes on. And so what has happened is, the people in the Bukalot, they have been able to, so far, be able to have coffee plantation, and this coffee has been able to grow, and they're sending it here. And they are able, we have missionaries down there, and they are able to go and spread the word of God. It's long stories. It will take a whole day. I don't have the whole day. But His will, I hope it's been done. So let us pray. Father God, I just want to thank You. I lift Your name up. I thank You for the gift of life. I thank You for who we are, for what we have that belongs to You. Father God, I just want to praise You and worship You for Your goodness and for Your generosity, for Your love that is unconditional that You poured in this church over today. Lord Jesus, we thank You. We glorify Your name. Because, Lord, all we do is for Your glory. Lord, you're worthy. You are the Lamb that is worthy, Father, oh God. And today I bring your children before you, Father. Father, bring these children to your presence, Jehovah, oh God. Father, may you shower them with your blessings, Father, oh God. May they go different. May they go out different than they walked into this church this morning, Father. Where there's pain, Father, may you relieve the pain, Father, oh God. Where there's sickness, Father, may you stretch your healing hand, Jehovah. May you bring healing, Father, oh God. May you heal, Jehovah. Father, where there's sickness, Jehovah, where there's weakness, Father, may you provide strength, Jehovah God. Where there's brokenness, Father Almighty, may you restore. Restore, Jehovah. Restore, Father, oh God. May you wipe away the tears, Jehovah, as you sell them in that bottle, Jehovah, oh God. Your word reminds us in Matthew 7:7, seek and you shall find, knock and those doors shall be opened unto you, ask and you shall receive. Jehovah Lord, even as we journey back, Father, for journey mercies we ask, Jehovah Father, may you take us back safely, Father. It's an honor to come here today and share your story, Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for loving on us. Thank you for being with us. Thank you for your presence that is felt in this church. And thank you for Chelsea and Babu, Father, oh God. May your blessings reign, Father. For today they are a standing testimony of your timing, Jehovah, oh God. Thank you for the friendship that we share. You brought us all farther away from different countries, Father. Just like you sent Abraham, your son, Jehovah. Today you brought us together, Father. We praise you, we praise you, we praise you, we praise you. We honor you, Father, oh God. Let your name reign, Jehovah. Let your name reign, Father Almighty. You are God and you are good. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for your wonders. Thank you for your creation. Thank you for the children that you have blessed us with, Father. Thank you for our families, far and near, Jehovah. May you bless their ways, Jehovah. May you bless their paths, Father, oh God. May your name be glorified. May your name be praised. Lord Jesus, you are Lord, and you are good, and you are a God who keeps his promises. And you are a God who hears our prayers whispered and even spoken and unspoken. You know our hearts, you know our thoughts. We praise you. We praise you. Hallelujah! 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 Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you. In your name I pray. Amen. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. That was a beautiful story. God is transforming lives in continents. Amen. And he's transforming life in the rural villages, the remote villages. Sometimes it is difficult to go to that places, but God is sending missionaries from America. Amen. God is at work. Do you believe that? God is at work and transforming life. That is what we hear today, what God is doing in Nairobi, Kenya, what God is doing in Philippines, and what God is doing among ourselves, amen, and even in the U.S. So God is an awesome God and wonderful God, and God wants us to do something for his kingdom, amen. So even our own country, so this is our missionary church. Calvary Light Our Church is a missionary church. We hear lots about mission work and great things, what God is doing. At this point, I want you to stand on your feet. We are going to spend a couple minutes praying for Philippines, praying for Kenya, even praying for America. Even God will allow us to, you know, go and touch lives. This is a missions month. We need to do something for the glory of God. We have to preach this eternal gospel. Amen. This month, like Wednesday, we are having a Love Your Neighbors, an outreach at one of our brother's house, Sunil's house. He called his 20 neighbors to come to his house. We are expecting 20 new neighbors to come and hear gospel. Amen. So we are going to do that. So we need your prayers. Amen. And we are going to reach them with the love of God and win souls for the kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ. And someone said in America, he's a missionary. If Americans choose to live a simple life, others can simply live, right? If you choose to live a simple life, others can simply live, right? What does it mean? You know, we hear the story, there are young children looking for some, you know, flip-flops, right? Sandals, some shoes. But where we take it for granted here, you know, that is the one thing I told Chelsea. Chelsea, I don't want to fall into a trap of having too much material. If I have two shoes, that's good for me. I don't want more than two or three shoes. But when I go to see my closet sometime, it is like somebody slapping on my face. What are you doing with all these shoes? So if we choose to live simple life, and others can simply live. Amen? So that is one of the ways disciples live. We minimize our lives and give to the needy people and reach them with the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? And your reward will be great in heaven. Hallelujah. Shall we go before God? God, thank you for this great day. Thank you for Hellen and Dave and their family and their obedience and their sacrifice to go to Kenya, go to Philippines and do great things for your kingdom. God, as they continue their mission along with the team, and I pray for your provision, and I pray for your protection, and I pray for the breakthroughs for the lives and for the entire mission team. Hallelujah. God, we pray for your blessings upon them, oh God, that you would surprise them with everything so that they are able to take care of those needy children in Kenya and the needy children in Philippines, oh Father. Continues to transform lives through their lives. And we heard that the local church started discipling the local people. How great it is. God, we want to see that transformation and this mission is keep growing. And they are able to reach their local people, oh God. Hallelujah. God, today we ask you that you will send us to do missions in Omaha. Do missions in abroad, oh God. Rise missionaries in this congregation. Rise preachers from this congregation. Rise evangelists from this congregation. Rise prophets from this congregation. Rise teachers of your word from this congregation. Somebody say, Lord, rise me up. And I want to do something for your kingdom, God. I don't want to waste time. I don't want to waste my energy. I don't want to waste my resources. And I want to utilize everything to win souls and building your kingdom, oh God. That is our prayer today. Oh, hallelujah. God, as we leave from this place, send us with this commitment that we are made to do something for your kingdom and make disciples. God, I pray that you'll go with us and bless us and give us an amazing week to win souls and bring souls to your kingdom. May the Lord be with you. May the Lord raise his face to shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious unto you. May the Lord bless your coming and your going. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. God bless.